Happy birthday, America. 246 years ago, our forefathers signed the Declaration of Independence. That's a long time. And I couldn't help noticing the sermon title for today, Unity and Diversity, goes right along with celebrating July 4th. We here at the United Church of Fayetteville welcome all of you, be it here in our historic sanctuary or viewing from simulcast. Speaking of our historic sanctuary, let's offer some more local happy birthdays. The current building dates back to 1872, so happy sesquicentennial, or 150th birthday. The village of Fayetteville celebrates 178 years in 2022. The town of Melius is 228 years old. Onondaga County, 206. New York State, 236. And perhaps the most important to the United Church of Fayetteville, we have been a united church since 1933, or 89 years. Happy birthday, us. So, on this 4th of July weekend, let us remember that there's more that binds us together than separates us in the worship of God. Now let us prepare ourselves for worship with a prelude. Friends, we gather on this holy day in the midst of a holiday weekend so that through our worship and praise, all our days might be made holy and we might see the grace of God in all its fullness. Together, let us worship the Lord.
Thank you.
Gracious and wonderful God, we praise you for all the gifts of our lives. This weekend especially, we give thanks for the freedom we have and for the people who act with honor and sacrifice on our behalf. We give thanks, too, for your redeeming, restoring work in our lives and among the nations, that empowered by you, we move ever toward the ideals of justice, mercy, and peace for the whole human community. With gratitude, we work toward the ends to which we pray. Amen. Friends, for us to know the experience of reconciliation with our God, we must do our parts to be right in a right relationship with our neighbors and with God. To that end, let us make our confessions together. Merciful God, we live in a complex world with challenging and sometimes opposing goals. Too often, we choose the easy way for ourselves and expect others to do what we are unwilling to do. Too often, our expectations of others are higher than those to which we hold ourselves. Forgive us. Restore in us the awareness that all your people act from good intentions with multiple gifts and limits. Help us to rebuild community that allows us to move forward together with all people, the ones with whom we agree and the ones with whom we disagree, for the sake of your people in every place. In Christ's name we pray. People of God, let us receive and live in the good news of forgiveness from God, through Christ who shows us the way for building our relationships. Having received the graces for forgiveness and renewal, let us make our gifts of thanksgiving and praise.
Through the meadows, the mountains, and the Hit it.
Let us pray. Bountiful God, in freedom we come, in freedom we worship, in freedom we give, in freedom we serve. Bless us and our offerings according to your purposes, that we might ever find our freedom in Christ, to live as you would have us live, and to do as you would have us do. In Christ's name we serve and we pray. Amen.
God's word to us today begins from the book of Samuel, and it is a description of David's coming to power in early Israel. Let us listen for God's word for us in this day and in this time. Then all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, "Look, we are your bone and flesh. For some time while Saul was king over us, it was you who led us out of Egypt, Israel, and brought it in. The Lord said to you, 'It is you who shall be shepherd of my people Israel, you who shall be ruler over Israel.' So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 40 years. At Hebron, he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months, and at Jerusalem, he reigned over all Israel and Judah for 33 years. David occupied the stronghold and named it the City of David. David built the city all around from the Millo inwards, and David became greater and greater, for the Lord, the God of hosts, was with him." So the history of Samuel tells us. Let us raise our voices in praise for God's enduring word. Our reading from the New Testament comes from St. Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, his second letter to the church at Corinth. You should recognize a piece of it because it is the benediction I have used every Sunday for nearly 15 years. Paul writes, "Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order, listen to my appeal, agree with one another, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you." So is God's benediction upon us in this word. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, on the breath of the wind, we pray for the breath of your Spirit. Fill us and inspire us with your word, that we might be fit for faithful living in these days. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. When I was in Israel in 1996, I received a small certificate to record the fact that I visited Jerusalem as it commemorated David's making the city his capital, the 3,000th anniversary of the events recorded in this morning's Hebrew scripture reading. When David made Jerusalem his capital, Israel was already almost 1,000 years into its recorded history and was just concluding its first royal reign. Saul was Israel's first king, designated by the prophet Samuel. His rise to king marked the end of the period of judges in Israel at the demand of the people, who wanted a king like other nations had kings. They had God as their king and the Lord of hosts to lead their armies, but somehow they thought they would be better off with a human king. God told Samuel to go ahead, but to warn the people of the problems they would face when they had a king like other nations. Their sons conscripted for wars, their property consumed by taxes to sustain armies and palaces, their daughters to be workers for the chosen friends of the ruler, and eventually find themselves slaves to the ever-demanding, ever-expanding needs of earthly royalty. I find myself regularly amused when people suggest that those old-time, old-fashioned writers of scripture really didn't understand how the world works. If the people heard Saul offer God's warning, they didn't care. Give us a king. And they got Saul, who was a successful chieftain and warrior before the demands of rule, of providing justice and leading armies, wore him down. Amid internecine battles, critical evaluations of his kingship by Samuel as God's spokesperson, and David's own machinations, Saul died in battle. While David had been designated by the aging prophet Samuel as God's next choice for king of the tribes of Israel, the fact that David was God's choice was, in fact, the third reason that the chieftains listed or indicated when asking him to rule, as mentioned in today's text. First, he was family, meaning he was more akin to the southern tribes than Saul had been. Secondly, when Saul had been too busy with other royal matters and probably suffered from mental illness to go out to war, it was David who went instead and led Israel's army. They do get around to mentioning that David was God's choice. David was Israel's second king, and under him, the tribes of north and south would be united in one nation. It was also under David's rule, far more so than under Saul's, that all God's warnings about what would happen to the people came true. Taxes, confiscation of property, conscription of people for war and labor, an enormous royal court, and grand building plans to support. Even with the great and magnificent King David, there would come a day when scripture would report. It was spring when kings went out to war, and David stayed home to watch a woman named Bathsheba take a bath. Soon the battles would again begin to consolidate power, to steal power, to retain power, to direct where power and extraordinary wealth would go after David's death, and all the related complications that had nothing to do with serving the people. The nation's glory would fade not long after David's death, coming apart during the reign of his son Solomon. This time, there would be two kingdoms, north and south, their rulers critically evaluated by their contemporaries as well as by history. Israel's history is full of cycles of excitement about new leadership, possibilities for justice and peace, hopes that the new person will have none of the limits or foibles of his predecessor, usually a his, hope and expectation that eventually crumbles into disappointment in the face of greed or illness, the complexities of governing, the costly demands of war and building programs, the divide between rich and poor, or simply human limits confronted by the demands of governing. What never seemed to change was the expectation that new blood, a new leader, was the answer, as though all history pivots on the abilities of one or two people. We are 3,000 years away from those events, and as Scott mentioned this morning, about a half a decade away from celebrating our nation's 250th anniversary. But the story sounds strangely familiar. Governing any nation is never simple. Governing ones filled with diversity of tribes, cultures, religions, ideas, and disparities in opportunity redefine what it means to be challenged. Yet again and again, people and nations expect others, yet somehow not themselves, to do just that. More than 70 years ago now, in a moment of frustration, responding to the myriad demands on his time, energies, and skill set, a post-war Charles de Gaulle asked, who could govern a country with 246 kinds of cheese? The world has become incredibly more complex, or it moves faster, or the news moves faster, or the world changes faster, or people's expectations are greater than in de Gaulle's time, let alone 3,000 years ago. What hasn't changed is individual and group expectations that personal passions will be met on a national scale, that somehow all the personal passions can be balanced, but if not, then let it be mine or yours or hers or whomever has the most money and the loudest voice. Last week at Wegmans, I stopped counting when I ticked off more than 300 kinds of cheese. It would be nice if cheese was our problem. But then or now, a varied diet, as opposed to some having more than enough to eat or others going to bed hungry, is not what makes a country complicated to govern. In the 2020 census, it was determined that there are at least 329,500,000 people here. Given the challenges of a pandemic, political animosity about who ought to be counted by whom and who paid, subsequent reporting indicates that is a significant undercount. Those people fell into seven categories of race and ethnicity, including mixed or other, and more than 20 religious traditions, with all non-Catholic, non-Mormon Christian traditions being counted as one. It takes a much more detailed reading to discern things like the number of registered Democrats or Republicans or Independents or Green Party or Libertarians, let alone those who vote a straight ticket, those who are pro-literacy or working against the death penalty, for justice, for public safety, for the planet, for an individual's control over their bodies, for hunger ministries, in education, for responsible gun ownership, for or against same-gender marriage, the wide spectrum of sexuality, those who have no access to medical care, and those who provide it, those with options for education and those who will never have them, those whose faith guides their opinions about the nature of public life, and those who object when faith does guide those decisions, or at least others' decisions. The increasing divide between rich and poor, and the devastating cancers of racism and violence, especially gun violence, that still tear our nation apart. It doesn't record who wants to fly the flag and who wants to burn it, who has fought under it and who's objected to its wars, who wants to kneel or turn away, and who removes their hats or covers their hearts. It doesn't even record how many people think we ought to have sung a national hymn in church today. You may well note that I always choose the one that suggests that as a nation, we still need God's help and we still need improvement. nor does it reveal the truth that even the small group of people in this room do not agree on any of those issues, let alone all of them. Nor will it reveal what we know to be the equally untidy truth, that no person can be analyzed in all categories by knowing where they fall in one. There is no census count that demonstrates how polarized we have become, how our attitudes continue to harden along lines of personal passion and the feeling that if you are not for what I am for, then you are against me. In the last week, the news has been filled with reports of soaring energy prices, lingering supply chain issues, protesters for and against any number of court decisions or activities of our fellow citizens. COVID and monkeypox are continuing to be of international concern. There are violent storms, climate change and its consequences, war in Eastern Europe, and the critique of elected officials in restoring the economy, immigration policy effectiveness, how to do that much needed rebuilding of the infrastructure. The demand that a handful of people quickly cure the nation of its ills, problems that have plagued our country for decades. All of it suggests that there is one person to blame, one direction for all fingers to be pointed, and absolutely none of those fingers are self-directed. Somehow, those of us on the sidelines know better than those in the trenches what to do and how to solve the problems. I'm not going to argue that we ought to be ruled by God and return to the age of judges and who gets to be a judge and who chooses, which is a reignited debate. Rather, I am going to remind us of two things. One, history shows us again and again that people get what they ask for. To cast a vote is not to absolve ourselves from responsibility for recognizing that just as we are the church, so we are the nation. It is not some other entity. As we are the church, we are the nation. To the degree that we ask for a refusal to compromise on issues important to us, while condemning others for their disinclination to compromise, where we continue to seek candidates who meet niche requirements of our personal agendas, where we seek superhumans who can do everything and have no flaws, in other words, we seek to elect the non-existent, where we refuse to set priorities in our personal lives, our voting lives, our faith lives, and our economic lives for those ideas which we espouse. To the degree that we seek the perfect person to govern us and to lead us, but refuse to be governed or refuse to be led, refuse to allow the implementation of decisions until all its parameters are according to our personal liking, so that governance grinds to a halt. To the degree that we refuse to engage the complex discussions demanded by the time, while expecting someone else to do it for us. And no single one of us is innocent of any or all of those failings. To the degree that we do all that, we contribute to the chaotic national life we deplore. As Franklin Delano Roosevelt once said, let us never forget that our government is ourselves and not an alien power over us. The ultimate rulers of our democracy are not a president and senators and congressmen and government officials, but the voters of this country. Two, as a people of faith, we are a post-Christ people called to do Christ's ministry of healing, reconciliation, and building up of community for the sake of the whole world. We are called to seek the wisdom of God and the inspiration of the Spirit in compromise. We are called to look around us and remember that even though we agree on very little, we have built a community here. We are bound to one another by faith and service, mutual regard and respect, caring, and serving. And we have the power to take the things we have learned here into the world, building such relationships wherever we find ourselves. We have the power and the vision and the skills to create safe places for disagreement, in reconciling people one to another, in accepting that people are human, and to take the lead in building the community and nation in which we live. As Scott reminded us, we've been doing it here since 1933 and here in Fayetteville since 1796. Let us be driven by the awareness that finding common ground, reconciling with others, seeking the positive in our life together, and doing the work of reconciliation is no easy overnight task. Let us be encouraged and inspired as we exit the days of pandemics with the knowledge and practice that we have gained in reaching out to the world around us, even when we could not be together inside these walls. Let us use what we learned when we lived outside these walls to reach those who regularly live outside these walls. Christ came, ministered, lived, and died for the sake of the whole world, not just a few. Can we, his faithful followers, do any less? Finally, St. Paul's charge and blessing to the church in Corinth is for us as well. Put things in order. Respond to my encouragement. Be in harmony with each other and live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Say hello to each other with a holy kiss. And all of God's people say hello to you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Friends, at this table, we find nourishment for our spirits and food for the journey and the challenges ahead of us. Let every one of us be fed at the table this day. Please join me in our prayer of preparation. The Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Most holy God, at this table, might we find the discipline to accompany our freedom, the grace to offer to others that which we treasure for ourselves, and the faithful commitment to offer all these things to those we know and those we have yet to meet. We pray in the name of the one who prepared this meal for us and who showed us the way to serve you. Amen. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus sat at table, and he took the bread, and giving thanks to God, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he offered it there, as we, ministering in his name, offer it here, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." This is the bread of life for us all. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is poured out for the forgiveness of sins of many." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he shall come again. This is the cup of salvation for us all. Let us continue to be in an attitude of prayer. Gracious God, our thanks know no bounds. They begin in this place with bread and cup, and they expand to include all who are gathered here, the ones you called us to be together with, and with whom we have built community, with whom we live and serve, care and share. Let us take all the gifts that you have given us and use them according to your purposes for the sake of the whole world. In Christ's name we pray, as he taught us to pray together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Thank you.
And now, may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.